I'm going to focus a bit more on the Dutch case and how the platforms and other stakeholders have negotiated about regulations, and more specifically, how you can theoretically explain the strategies of these platforms and why different platforms apply actually different strategies. But before I'm going to talk about that, I will spend a few minutes on the definition, because I can use my definition also to classify these different platforms along a certain dimension. So this is my definition. It's about consumers who grant each other temporary access to their underutilized goods. And this can be for money or not. So for me, it's really about goods and not about services. This is a practice that predates the internet, because before the internet, we also lend out or rented out goods to others, mostly family and friends. And now we also do it with strangers. And for that, we use those platforms, because the platforms create the trust by insurances or rating systems that allow us to trust those strangers. Now, my definition consists of three parts. It's about consumer-to-consumer interaction, it's about temporary access, and it's about physical assets, goods, houses, parking spaces. And if you tweak one of those three constituting elements, you actually enter a different kind of economy, which also has become organized through online platforms. And this is what you can do here. So if we have a platform that is about C2C, temporary access, and physical goods, I call it sharing economy. For example, Airbnb or car sharing. However, if we talk about consumers who grant each other permanent access to their goods, they sell their goods, so we talk about eBay, secondhand markets. If we talk about consumers who grant each other temporary access to their labor, to their time, we talk about services, not goods. So Uber, for me, is on-demand economy. And if we talk about business-to-consumer sharing, we talk about businesses who own goods that are rented out on a temporary basis to consumers. So here you have your traditional car rental company. I use this definition in my talk today because I want to show you that I focus on this part and on this part. And actually, I can rank all my seven platforms on a continuum between pure sharing economy, if you like, and pure on-demand economy, and things that you may want to position a bit in between. Okay, before I'm going to do that, let me first pose the research question here. How do sharing and on-demand platforms manage to avoid and also change regulatory institutions? And the way I approach this question, and this is very much in development, I have no paper yet, I'm still thinking about this idea. But the framework I use is Battilana's paper on institutional entrepreneurship. And this notion is a bit older than 2009, but I think this was the first paper that really came up with a theory that provided a couple of hypotheses under which conditions and by what kind of actors can you expect institutional change to happen. So I think for sociology, obviously, a big question. But also in innovation studies, where I come from, innovation often prompts institutional change, and in turn, new institutions further shape the development of these technologies. So there's a co-evolution of technology and institutions in this case. Now, what they basically said is there are field-level conditions. So the context here is the field, the sector. And if the sector currently has institutions that are legitimate and clear, so non-complex, you don't expect a lot of institutional change to happen. So for example, in the Dutch case, we have a taxi market where there was a new law in 2000 with a high degree of legitimacy, pretty clear, and that law in a way prevented institutional change for now. But this obviously can differ across sectors. Then there are also actor characteristics. The people who try to change institutions need to be high status actors. and need to be able to mobilize resources. And often they do that in packs, they do that collectively, where you see multiple actors with heterogeneous interests, nevertheless pursuing the same institutional change. And that's also something I will focus on in this topic. And the last hypothesis Battilana posed is that she said, if a particular actor is embedded in multiple fields or in multiple geographical skills, it's easier to change institutions because you can leverage the fact that you can selectively shop, if you like, across institutions in multiple fields you're active in. And that's also a typical strategy I've seen in sharing. Now, these are the seven platforms I'm going to focus on. And these are all operating in the Netherlands, but some are, actually most are also operating abroad. We have PeerB, where you can rent or borrow items from people in the neighborhood. Usually no money involved. There's even no rating system involved. Rens can tell you all about it. Then we have SnappCar. That's your traditional or your peer-to-peer car sharing platform, which is growing pretty fast, second largest in Europe. Airbnb, then we have Airdnd, Drink and Dine. They haven't been sued yet by Airbnb for having a label that's very close to Airbnb. But this is an Netherlands-only platform where you can book a home restaurant and then you can have dinner at someone else's home, for example, with a group of friends or a collective blind date. UberPop, so not Uber generally, but UberPop, the service that uses unlicensed taxi drivers to bring people from A to B, is now banned, but was active for about 2 years in the Netherlands. Helpling, where you can rent a cleaner per hour above minimum wage. Solving, in their view, the problem that currently cleaning markets in the Netherlands is an informal market, and they may be able to make it more formal. And then we have Werkspot, that's more yellow page for handymans, where you can get offers when you want to have some construction in your home. It's already taken over by an American, similar American platform. Now, I ordered these platforms from sharing economy, on-demand economy, hybrids. Okay, for example, on Airbnb, there are also people who are not renting out their home when they're away, but actually running a business by owning multiple homes. Here you can say, is it sharing your house or is it providing a service? Well, you mainly pay for the service of someone who knows how to cook, usually like 40 euros. This is mainly a service, although they may use their own car, but they may actually have bought a car to start this service. You cannot say it's truly idle. And here you really rent their services. And these are even licensed. They're all registered at the Chambers of Commerce. And they have no regulatory issues. Now, then I also use another notion, the notion of institutional logics. And correct me if I'm wrong, I'm not a sociologist, but I think this is a kind of 101 list of institutional logics in sociology, that most of our activities are organized in one of these seven logics, or maybe a combination of these. And historically, of course, these were very important. You also mentioned pre-modern ways of exchange. But in the 19th and 20th century, we mostly institutionalized things through these four logics. So most things you purchase on a market. You buy it from a corporation that employs professional people who have a diploma or a license. And it's all regulated by the state. And if you want to push a bit what platforms are bringing to society, what kind of new institutions they are, you could say that the platform, is all about creating a marketplace, And they substitute these three older logics. They don't need corporations anymore because they only work with freelancers who are then coordinated and planned through an algorithm. Okay, so what corporations are good at, planning what people have to do and overseeing that they do it well, that's what we have hierarchies for, that's now being substituted by algorithms who oversee these people and plan what they have to do at what time, in what place. Also, they don't use the logic of professions because you don't need necessarily a diploma, you don't need necessarily a license. What they do is they have pre-checks before you enter a platform. Most platforms, they do a check on criminal record, or they may ask you for references. They may ask you for a passport, but then you can just offer your service. And if exposed, they don't feel the quality of your service is sufficient, they ban you from the platform. So they don't need diplomas or licenses. If you have bad reviews, you are disqualified and you're banned from the platform. And that's also why they don't need state regulations, because most of the state regulations are about protecting the consumer, safety, health, insurance issues, and they claim that through those reviews, you don't need classic regulatory institutions. We heard about it in the first talk. Now, interestingly, while bypassing these logics and focusing on the market logic, they do refer to the family and the community logic. But I put it between quotation marks because you could argue whether or not it is truly according to this family and community logic. For example, Airbnb would say, well, if you stay at someone's home, you are considered a family member. Yeah? And you can really learn how someone is living and be part temporarily of that family. They also, as you said, like Couchsurfing has these meetups of hosts, Airbnb does the same. So they also want to make a community of their member, but it's mostly a virtual community. Now, what I then did is I checked for each of these platforms through interviews and also their public statements, what kind of logics they invoke to justify the way they're operating. And what is interesting is that PRB and SnappCar, they mainly focus on the community logic. They are local, they increase the social cohesion, they claim, and they say they're not in there for the money and so forth. So they want to strengthen local communities. On the other extreme, we have Helpling and Werkspot, so the cleaning and the handyman platforms, and they actually emphasize the old logics. Yeah. So Werkspot is saying, listen, we only work with small businesses that are registered with the Chamber of Commerce. Yeah, we don't do anything illegal, and they actually don't. And they call themselves, they make reference to Yellow Pages or Booking.com, existing corporations that have more legitimacy. Helpling wants to solve a problem for the state, because the state is struggling with informal labor in the cleaning market. And they say, listen, if we are able to organize this market, we can try and help you collect taxes over these people. For now, they don't do it, but they want to work with governments to help solve this problem. It is more, okay. Now, these three are the more problematic platforms because they cannot credibly claim community logic, and they cannot also credibly claim they are operating according to the old logics. So what they do is they stress this family and community logics in a way that can be discussed, but they also invoke new logics. Logics that sociologists would not call logics yet, but they want them to become logics. So they refer to sustainability logic. they say, listen, this is incidental labor. It's like a hobby. Why would we prevent people to exercise their hobby, cooking? Okay, and because it's incidental, you should not see it as work, and you should not tax it, and you should not regulate it. They emphasize, again, the family part. It's like saying, if you're going to have dinner at a stranger's place, it is the same as going to a family's member. Yeah, it is, see it as the private sphere, the family sphere. And this, for me, is the most interesting logic. They refer to the tech logic. So what Uber, for example, has been saying, at least in the Netherlands, in almost all public statements, as the first sentence, we are Uber, a technology company that dot, dot, dot. They wouldn't call themselves a taxi service or a transportation company. They call themselves a technology company. And they develop technology that allow people to organize rides. Okay, and even if you talk to Pirby, he also considers himself a technology company. And this tech logic is, let's say, replicating legitimacy from Silicon Valley type of operators. It's the logic of social media, it's the logic of e-commerce, it's the logic of eBay. That is, it is the logic of using internet platforms that are operated outside your own territory, mostly in the US, and also regulated in those countries and cannot be escape local regulation. Now, I think you can already see from this description that the most problematic platforms are those that ad hoc refer to different logics in different contexts, just trying to invoke whatever argument they think to legitimize their business. And they struggle. Now, what then is the process of institutional entrepreneurship that you can find, especially in these three platforms? How, although they have no clear institutional logic that they can adhere to, they have no clear legitimacy in the beginning, how can they nevertheless be operational and grow very fast? Well, first, they try to find a market that is currently, let's say, overregulated, that's currently inhabited by rent-seeking incumbents. There are profits to be made. They don't pick just any market. They pick markets where efficiency gains are able to realize. And especially markets in which the institutions are weak or complex. And for example, the hotel market, it looks like a strong institutionalized market. But before the advent of Airbnb, we already had a lot of illegal hotels in Amsterdam. So there was already a big problem. And there was, if you like, already a user practice, informal user practice, that they, in a way, made bigger. So the same even for taxi drives. There were already illegal taxis that you could order in Amsterdam. So this existing informal practices, they scale up and make bigger. And this is now what you see happening with many startups. They try to copy this in other sectors. Now then the second step is they have to they have to create protection from existing regulations. They have to find a way to continue their operations despite the fact that it's not consistent with current regulations. And this is actually mainly done by the fact that the data they generate and use for their operations fall under privacy laws, so they are not obliged to release them neither to scientists nor to public authorities. So authorities cannot enforce their regulations. And this is the big thing with Airbnb in Amsterdam, that they are not sharing their data, so all the regulations that have been created in Amsterdam are not enforced. another, if you like, protective space is that these platforms enter markets in which most transactions are one-off. Okay? Because you're not going every week to fly to the same city and book the same house. You're not having the same transaction with the same taxi driver every day, and you're not going to have dinner with the same guy in the same house every week. So because you transact one-off, the trust that is created is only used in that one-off transaction. And the second transaction you do again with a stranger, and again trust has to be created. So that's why this platform can, for every transaction, stand in between a provider and user. However, there are also platforms like Helpling, where you have recurrent transactions, because if you like your cleaner, next week you will want to hire the same cleaner, and then you can go and bypass the platform and just call the cleaner, and you don't need to pay the fee to the platform. So their business model is, capable of replicating itself because people engage in one-off transactions. What is interesting, I think, is that because they create this protection and they can continue to grow and grow and grow, this obviously creates more tension, because if it would have remained small, governments would not have bothered. But now it's growing so big, tension is created. But at the same time, they create legitimacy, not with authorities, but with the users, because users like it, and users are also voters. So users, especially hosts or taxi drivers, they may start to defend these platforms, and this is also how they operate. They try to mobilize the users of their platforms as advocates of their platforms vis-a-vis regulatory agencies. And then we have the final phase, that once you have created this empty space, if you like, this institutional void, and you make it bigger and bigger, at some point you have to re-institutionalize it. Now, we cannot continue and have these platforms operating completely outside current institutions. At the same time, you cannot make them consistent with existing institutions, so the only way out is to change the institutions. And that's what we now see slowly happening. For example, Uber negotiating with the Dutch government for a new taxi law that doesn't require you to invest 5,000 euros, but maybe 200 euros to become a licensed driver, and then we can all get our license and we can all become part-time taxi drivers, and then their initial illegal model is made legal. Okay. Same for Airbnb. They renegotiated their deal with Amsterdam, and their new step is to say, listen, we are going to execute your regulations. We are going to enforce them ourselves, because we don't want to hand over the data of individual users, but we make sure that those users that do not adhere to the 60-day maximum rule, for example, are banned from the platform after they have rented out their home for 60 days. So you see, step for step, a kind of process of mutual adjustments of regulatory bodies and the platforms adjusting their business model. And from a spatial point of view, you see this happening in three regulatory levels at the same time. But you see different things happen at different levels. So local municipalities, they have to deal with the problems, because these platforms are only growing big for now in the largest cities. So they come up with ad hoc regulations, mainly to divide the market into professional and non-professional providers, by saying, okay, you can only do it 60 days. If you want to rent out your home for more than 60 days, we consider you a professional, and then you need a license for a bed and breakfast, which actually there are 5,000 in Amsterdam. Same for Airdnd. They are lobbying for a one day a week cap, saying, okay, if you use your house as a restaurant just for one day a week, we don't consider you professional. If more, we think restaurant regulations apply. And here you could, in principle, also think of caps. For example, the number of hours or the amount of money you would be allowed to earn. But in this case, in the Netherlands, there was not a solution through a cap, but through a complete ban for now. At the national level, both governments and platforms are thinking about deregulation. I already gave the example of Uber. By making it much easier to become a licensed driver, by having less regulations, then the Uber model can become a legal one. Then there's also something like a right to challenge. That's a kind of meta policy now in the Netherlands that grants new platforms the right to challenge existing institutions as long as they allow then the platform to be evaluated after a year if the platform still adheres to the goals of the old regulations. Okay, we can talk about it if we have time. And then at the European level, the Commission is saying, listen, we should embrace these platforms because they are consistent with EU e-commerce directives. They are about innovation, standardization, free markets, and that's the discourse at the European level. So this is now happening. So I'm almost wrapping up. But then the story is about how do these seven platforms, and they're obviously a bit more than that, how do they collaborate? How do they engage in collective institutional entrepreneurship? Because part of the theory of Battilana is to say, and also others that came after, it's not the heroic Schumpeterian entrepreneur that on his own is changing these regulations. They usually collaborate among them, because even though they have heterogeneous interests, they have a common goal to gain legitimacy as sharing. And that was what happening in the beginning, because at that time, all these platforms and others would call themselves sharing economy platform. Okay? And they were also organized in ShareNL. They were members of ShareNL and they paid a small fee. But after a while, some of these platforms lost their legitimacy, mainly Uber, I'm sorry. and because of that loss of legitimacy of one platform, the others did not want to be associated anymore with Uber. So two things happened. First, ShareNL said, we are going to change ourselves from an industry representation through a true independent consultancy. So you cannot be a member anymore of ShareNL. Also because otherwise journalists would not ask them for their opinion anymore and things like that. And second, these kind of platforms were saying, listen, we are the true sharing economy. This is not real sharing economy. And they were saying, listen, we have never been sharing economy. we are gig economy. This is about services. And so from both sides, they are sandwiched, okay? Because they cannot gain legitimacy by aligning with these, and they cannot gain legitimacy by aligning as gig platforms. So what they are saying in the interviews, yeah, it's all semantic. What's in the name, sharing? We don't care, we just want to make our clients happy, yeah? So they put all their eggs in the basket of practical legitimacy, gaining popularity with users. And they are still successful in that in most countries. So to wrap up, back to the research question. My research question is, how do platforms avoid existing regulation and also now recently start to actively change this regulation? And the theory of institutional entrepreneurship gives you four type of factors, four type of determinants. You have to look at the sectoral context. You have to look at individual characteristics, so the actor level. You have to look at how actors act in groups, how they engage in collective action, and to what extent they find common common grounds. And you have to check if these actors operate in multiple fields or multiple skills at the same time and know how to leverage this. Now, if you check this theory, it's pretty good. It's really pretty good. And in fact, the theory was never invented as a theory of innovation. It was they were more looking at social movements and so forth. But it is also it also pretty well applies, I think, to these platforms. First, they say the contextual factors can be either sudden shocks, so jolts or external events, that provide a window of opportunity for institutional change. And I think here the external events was the rise of the smartphone, which was obviously completely external to all these traditional markets. You could say liberalization, for example, of the taxi market, or what happened in many countries, and the e-commerce law, which was an Al Gore law in, and also copied more or less by European Commission, which grants platforms a lot of freedom and at the same time the right to keep data secret from governments while being able to sell their data to other businesses. Yeah. So so you sign if you rent with Airbnb, you sign a contract saying I don't want you to sell my show my data to governments, but allow you to sell my data to any other commercial party. It's what you sign for. They could change that terms of contract, but this is how it works now. And that's actually how all the e-commerce businesses already operate to a large extent. At the same time, you could say, yeah, some of these markets indeed had pretty complex regulations. So they can make use of the fact that the current system is unclear, it's complex, there's already a lot of misuse. But to some extent, the complexity of current regulation is also a social construction of the platforms. Because Uber, when they entered the Netherlands, they said, listen, taxi regulation is a mess. Yeah, and prices are still too high, and so the whole law of 2000 failed. Okay? So they were saying, yeah, current institutions are not clear. Let's make it simpler and let's make it more efficient. At the same time, they also said, we are actually doing what the law was hoping. We are bringing competition, and that was why the new law was implemented in the first place. So on the one hand, they refer to the law as backing them. On the other hand, they say the law is a problem because it's too complex. So my, let's say, extension or addition to the theory of entrepreneurship is that, yes, contextual factors matter, but they are not necessarily objective. Yeah, what is seen as a relevant contextual factor is negotiated. Yeah, and of course, incumbents say the law is very clear. But Uber says, no, the law is not clear. Yeah, so that's an interesting process of framing. Are they high status actors and access to resources? Again, something that's socially constructed. Why? These platforms say, we are just an innocent startup. Yeah? Give us some time, we are small, we're doing innovation. Because they don't want to be regarded as high status actors, because they don't want to take responsibility given current institutions. But at the same time, if you look closely at the founders and who finances them, very often they are high status factors. And they have access to resources. For example, Uber from day one was backed by large funds. Even Airdnd, which is indeed still small, is backed by the former Ministry of Finance, Jan Kees de Jager. So there are some interesting people doing this. Yeah, 1 minute. Collective entrepreneurship, yes, but up to a point. In the beginning, they have a joint interest, but when things grow and become more controversial, they start their coalition starts to break. And I think you could have expected that from the theory of collective action. And finally, they make use of being embedded in multiple fields or multiple spatial scales at the same time. In particular, on the one hand, they say we are in the hospitality business, for example. But if appropriate for them, they say, no, we are just a technology company, because we operate according to e-commerce law. Yeah, so hotel regulations do not apply to us. And also spatially, by being a global platform and also being registered abroad, they can often escape local institutions. So this is it for me, and I hope it's still time for some questions. Otherwise, maybe in the break or during the drinks, I'm happy to receive any comments or suggestions.